Thanks for the invitation. I will pick up the knowledge transfer part to give a kind of testimony on the experiment that took place over the past 3 years under the name of the Delta Atelier, where in fact the pooling of different and diverse capacities was seen and also proved to be an instrument to multiply change. What is the Delta Atelier? It's an environment where we actually said this Delta is interesting to draw maps of, and that would be the map I would show behind me, but I couldn't find the non-PowerPointed version to show behind me fast enough. But that's actually a map where we actually showed different practices. So from national governments to local initiatives, local initiators, citizens initiatives, design offices, we invited them in the framework of the Rotterdam Architecture Biennale, and you are here in Brussels in 2018, to join a common effort. And the common effort that we sketched was to hack the missing link, to say we see that we are doing a lot of experiments on the one hand, bottom left, but we don't succeed to mainstream them. On the top right, we see that we have a multitude and gradually more very ambitious goals and plans, but we don't succeed to organize them their landing. And so the gap in between is really our main focus and struggle. And if we want to touch upon this gap, we will need to pool our capacities. Maybe that would help. First point I would like to make is that the observations we made is that the big challenges we are facing, if we want to answer them in a systemic way, we have to go upstream. We can't think in big transformations. We can't think in big answers to big problems. We actually see that each of the problems, the energy transition, the water challenge, the food transition, actually requires a multitude of transformations. If we look at the global map of water challenges, you hear I'm speaking from Brussels, the police passing by, not for me. The big water challenges at a global scale, if we want to deal with this at a global scale, there's of course a lot of action that is necessary in terms of climate agreements and so on. But finally, it boils down to the fact that we cannot solve it with one-off measures. And so the idea here envisioned for the Belgian coast to solve sea level rising, to answer sea level rising with the rising, building a little wall in front of the dike, is actually not the approach we will have to take. If we look at the Eurodelta maps that the association Deltametropool has made in a collaboration we did on the future of the lowlands, then you see that the water challenges come from anywhere, everywhere, and that if you look down into the regions such as, dealing with drought problems such as North Brabant or the city region around Ghent, or you look at Brussels, which is actually a marshland that has been built completely and which continues to have more impermeability while it actually wants to advocate for more impermeable or permeable surfaces to deal with the peak rain and climate adaptation, then we see that actually the main challenge is to go upstream. A big plan, a big agreement, a big deal about all of these subjects is really difficult. We see that it's also difficult to turn into action. We see here all the reports that are made from Brussels to the Netherlands on the water challenges, and we actually see that finally it boils down to something completely different, not the plan making, but finding a way to mobilize coalitions on the ground. Here an example that I will go into a little bit later, coalitions between farmers, nature conservationists, landscape developers, local municipalities. If they can come together around the project then and adapt simultaneously, then it works. Same example in Brussels. A lot of Brussels is not a mountainous city, but we have some slopes. It means that if you have peak rain, that some streets, especially the lower lying streets, are really problematic. How can we make sure that in the fabric of Brussels, we build more capacity to infiltrate in every street? That means that you have to think of a completely different project. And that's really where the problem arises. The next big thing will be a lot of small things. And we are still structured in a way, governance-wise, but also as a practice of design. And we're educating the next designers even in the same way, which is the worst part of the story, to answer to questions that are given, mostly questions that are about big project, big design questions, while actually we know that we need to provoke a lot of small changes in many places. That's kind of a mindfuck, to use a very dirty word, I'm apologizing in the meantime, for our practice as a whole, but also for our political system as a whole. This requires a new wave of projects, capacities, and practices of transformation. That's a crucial one, with an example going to Chennai, and a very, let's say, it speaks for itself nearly. Chennai is at the coast. It's a city that has that is built because of the presence of water, of course. But it's, of course, if you take the section, you see that the fact that the water system is broken up by continuous urbanization means that people pump up the water out of the groundwater. The city sinks at the same time sea level rises. And then we hope that building a dike would solve everything at the same time. Chennai is the city where we see the trains driving in with drinkable water, while actually the city is flooded at the same time with brackish and dirty water. So we see that there's a real challenge. If you want to deal with these types of challenges, and I'm looking at the work that OOS has been developing with a big consortium within the Water as Leverage program, then you see that instead of thinking of a big plan, it's actually a strategy where they say we need to go back to the local communities. We need to find a way. If we look at the whole scheme of how the aquifer has been nurtured, we need to find a way to go back to the local culture, local communities, and find a way to mobilize again a connection between social and economic life and the water challenges. And so what they proposed is to reinterpret the typical reverse temples that actually harvest water in times of drought to capture it and make it available in other moments in time. They say we need to move to a system where we can structure 1,000 tanks for this city, 1,000 neighborhood communities that work together to solve this water challenge. So this requires a completely different practice. It's not about calculating by engineers and drawing big strategies for the whole city as a whole, but it's about finding a method to engage with local communities. It's more socio-anthropological urban design work than it is about being right in what you draw for the whole city at once. Third, we can incite and enable many local coalitions through transformation programs and communities of practice. We are building a practice, and now I'm diving deep into an example from Flanders. If you look at how companies locally, together with municipalities, need to work together, here an example of Burenwater, so neighborhood water, they're trying to find a way to collaborate locally to store the water, to reuse processed water from the industry, and so on. This cooperation is actually hindered by many rules and regulations, by the fact that the subsidies for dealing with water by the industry is a different subsidy scheme than the subsidy scheme for people in the farming industry dealing with water, and is a different logic than the local municipalities use to deal with the same water. And that's actually where our real problem lies. And so Water Landscape is an ambitious program, an experimental program, maybe better, where actually an attempt was made to form a supra-local coalition of different stakeholders that would enable, through a call for local coalitions, that would enable local coalitions to have a one-stop shop, you could say, to have one environment, one framework, and not seven or eight different types of governments where they have to ask whether their local project would make sense for each of these eight, where it would actually be multiplied. This call was actually an interesting experiment. 40 candidates were submitting a proposal, 40 local coalitions in Flanders, which is an incredibly small portion of Europe. These 14 were supported by expertise, by designers. They met each other. They started to be involved in a community of practice. And now, in fact, Water Landscape 2.0 was launched 2 days ago, where the double amount of support system and money was launched. An inspirational guide was made for this community of practice to triple in terms of size. In the meantime, the experimental projects on drought were also launched, on dehardening were also launched. And you could say that all in all, about 100 types of projects are being experimented with. and always guided by, on the one hand, a supra-local program team that is responsible for maintaining the mission and the goal, supporting local coalitions in all of these locations. And in fact, this mobilization of these local coalitions is really interesting, because suddenly from exceptional projects that are pilots, we move to transformation programs, but also governments are pushed to actually adapt their frameworks. And we're not yet there. We didn't cross the gap of the missing link, but still we're getting closer to one another. The integral water management of Flanders is now being rethought in light of this approach, building these coalitions, instead of allowing or thinking that water expertise would be the most important aspect of an integral water management. Fourth, and I'm going to the end, no transversal projects, coalitions and programs without pooling and connecting diverse insights and capacities. We are doing enormous efforts in many places, different stakeholders, local initiatives, supra-local entities, companies are testing how they have to deal with water. And one of the biggest problems is that if we want to accelerate transformation, then distributed or dispersed knowledge is our worst enemy. So we really need to find a way to collect knowledge. The biennial in Rotterdam, for example, in 2018, but in other editions as well, is an attempt to actually offer a podium, but also to structure the dispersed knowledge, to bring it together and to offer it as a more structured database or knowledge base or library. The same happened in a Brussels exhibition, but then also bringing stakeholders together. Here we see a session within the Delta Atelier in 2018, where the man standing up is Wiebe Oosterhoff from the municipality of Rotterdam, pitching the importance of urban maintenance, so not the design, but the maintenance of public spaces, sewage system, green spaces, and so on, and saying we should use this. It's 15 billion euros a year in the Netherlands that we are spending on maintaining our road and green infrastructure on a yearly basis. Can we use this for climate adaptation? Well, we with this group, we wrote down what potential strategies could be. So bottom up, what is the next step? What do we know already and what is the next step? And out of this came a Delta Atelier experimental track on urban maintenance, where in fact the possibilities, the challenges, the next steps were unraveled, and that influenced, together with the work done in Amsterdam and the work commissioned by the national ministry, BZK, led to the city deal Beheer van Openbare Ruimte, where a next community of practice is being set up. And I can give this example also for other subjects. The protests in school streets against bad air quality and a mobility system was picked up in a designerly session to see how we can actually make new types of proposals. My conclusion, fifth point, to multiply the transformation of our Delta, we really need the intermediate societal platforms and incubators, not next to or against the system that is in place, but as an aid, as an enabling environment for the different authorities, capacities, energies that we can find both in existing silos and on the field. We need a form of a platform logic. This Delta, which is in the midst of enormous challenges, the SDGs or whatever other supra or meta framework you can use, and at the same time is full of initiative in many places. How can we transform this Delta not only via the drawing of or the making of big agreements, so minister presidents meeting every 2 years and agreeing on what is important and how it should happen, but also mobilizing the capacities of very different stakeholders. The Delta Atelier was a peer-to-peer action and knowledge platform that was tested as an experiment since 2018. And if we look back, we see that this group of practices, first it grew. There's from the first 50 practices, we are nearly going towards 150 practices involved in different trajectories. We see that it's a form of multiplier. So when you bring people together to set a common agenda, it starts to launch trajectories, such as the city deal public space, and in Belgium, a street deal on how to deal with other things, next to some things on other subjects. And if we look at the experiments, we see that the qualities, that's actually a looking back publication we're trying to finish now, we see a number of experimental dimensions. First, we need mobilizing narratives that can mobilize very different stakeholders from within governments to local stakeholders. Second, it's a kind of chamber of practice. It's a kind of room where practices are not waiting for others to commission them, but where practices on the basis of their experience can help define what the next step is and start to be entrepreneurial. Practices from within government again and from the educational research and other participants that are here today. Third, build a shared agenda. So come together, define what the next steps are. Fourth, use imagination, culture and design to actually provoke. So it's not about waiting for the question to come, it's provoking new coalitions, new trajectories. It's being entrepreneurial about it. And the what if power of design and imagination is crucial to that, because it's about envisioning what could be possible. It's about also facilitating these types of environment. It's not about, it's not a neutral environment. You don't come there and you can do whatever you want. It's also a thing that needs to be moderated, facilitated, edited, so that actually it starts to make sense and steps are being made. Explorations are made according along topics such as management. And it forms a form of a kind of incubator of trajectories that finally lead to spin-offs and things that go out. So you bring expertise in this room and it goes out in the other hand. And that's maybe a way, an experiment where this Delta, more than a map and more than a physical system, it's also a kind of system of knowledge transfer, which we have to structure much better. And if we can structure it much better, it actually produces new types of coalitions on the ground and new types of inter-coalitions, coalitions in a transnational way to actually develop the capacities and the practices we need to develop further. We are trying to take this one step further with a project or develop a similar type of learning environment, online library of strategies and an incubator for new type of investment programs. With the Great Transformation 2020-2030, which we're launching tomorrow night, where we actually took it one step further, building on all the knowledge that is there. We said, in fact, we know what we need to realize. The only question is how. We need more food parks for local and biological food production. We need new in the mobility system. We need new flow collectors. We need to build climate streets and energy districts. And in fact, we can actually start from the other, we can reverse the logic completely, start from what we have to do and bring everyone maybe together around this so that we can find together the ways we to do this. And in fact, by pooling these capacities, we sensed during the experience of the Delta Atelier that this is a method to actually multiply change. Thank you.